And the first item on this evening's agenda is the review of the previous meeting notes from April 25th, 1994. Does anyone have any comments, corrections? Judy?
Just a minor comment on a typo on page six. Next to the last.
Just a minute, Judy. I have a problem with the tape.
Okay.
Take two.
Once again, I'll call the May 17, 1994 regular meeting of the Planning Board, Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, to order. And the first item on tonight's agenda is a review of the previous meetings. And Judy Lardner, you had referred us to page six.
On the third paragraph down, first, or next to the last line, wheel stop instead of stope. Just a minor typo.
Okay. Anything else? By your motion?
Propose a motion to accept the minutes as amended.
A motion. Do I hear of a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. The next item on this evening's agenda is quite an extensive list of memoranda. Including, I will just introduce the items on the list. They're all quite extensive and somewhat detailed. Is a memorandum from the town manager regarding a gift policy, which has been sent to several of the town boards, and the planning board will be looking at that memo in more detail. A copy of a letter from the Farm Hill to the Farm Hill Road abutters regarding encroachments. A memorandum from the school superintendent regarding the proposed detention basin, informing them of the revisions to the plan. A memorandum from the planning board to the council regarding lot 2 and 13A. The board did not recommend that the council deed that property to the abutter. Revised floodplain management ordinance that has some oil burner equipment code and other miscellaneous information attached to it. Appropriate for my own needs. a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding the Jelen boat dock. A letter from Joseph Groff regarding the Jelen boat dock. I had a question of the town planner. Is that official, is he acting in legal representation of the abutters?
I'm not aware whether he's, I don't believe that the abutters have officially hired someone.
Okay.
But his response was delivered by someone who's a member of the association.
Okay. Just for the record, we get several correspondences throughout the year that come from abutters who are in professions that, for convenience sakes, I suppose, put memorandums to the planning board on their professional letterheads. And we'll make a determination during the review as to whether or not that he is, in fact, acting as a legal representative. We have a memorandum from the Conservation Commission regarding the Linnell public access waiver, and we'll review that with a packet. Environmental and Development newsletter distributed by the town planner with a lot of interesting information. I hope that we've all had a chance to review that at some point. A letter from Jerry Bryant, the town manager of South Portland, regarding the Rosewood subdivision. I would like to make a comment regarding that. It's quite a lengthy letter and deals with the issue that we invited the public to a workshop meeting of the planning board in an effort to be more customer friendly. And there's a reference to the chairman in that letter And for the record, I would like to simply state that the chair's reference in the letter was that it was our understanding, or my understanding, that any issues dealing with access or connecting to utilities was being initially reviewed at the administrative level. It was nothing more or less meant by that at the time. And the letter from the school's superintendent regarding portables, at the last meeting, a member of the planning board had requested that there be an investigation of possible connections for toilets and water supply to the portables. And I suppose we can get to that response as part of the school building project. I have on my desk this evening several pieces of correspondence to Ms. O'Meara from the VE, Nathan. A couple of envelopes, again from the Nathans, from Wildwood on the Cape. Correspondence from Clint Willis regarding the Jelen boat ramp. Correspondence regarding the Rosewood subdivision. This is a Right Stuff correspondence, Maine Municipal Association. And attended a planning board agenda for the next coming meetings. Any questions? I trust we all had the same information in the pack. Okay, with that then, what I'd like to do at this time is move ahead to old business. And the first item for discussion under old business this evening is the school building project. And I would ask that the town planner bring us up to date with a brief introduction, and then that the applicant review for the board and for anyone that's interested in the audience any changes and revisions to the plan since our last meeting. Maureen?
The Cape Elizabeth School Department is requesting site plan approval for renovation and new construction at the middle and elementary schools. The board has deemed the application complete, and a public hearing was held at the last meeting. You have before you a memo for me and also a revised motion for approval for your consideration. Any questions?
Would the applicant at this time please just briefly review any revisions to the plan since our last meeting? And since we have the chairman of the building committee making a brief introduction, I suppose, would you also bring us up to date with respect to your schedule and bidding? I saw an advertisement in this weekend's paper, and I'd just like a clarification as to the specific purpose of that.
Okay, my name is Paul Liliberty, and I am chairman of the Elementary and Middle School Building Committee. I'd like to thank Chairman Emery and the Planning Board this evening. We hope, of course, this will be our last review before your committee and receive approval this evening. Our schedule at the moment is we have pre-qualified contractors for bidding on the project. We went through a pretty long qualification process to ensure that we had the most competent people qualified to do this project. We have a list of about 16 contractors that have been pre-qualified. Whether they all bid, we certainly don't know that answer yet, but we think it should be a good competitive bid. Schedule is very critical. As you well know, we must be able to start construction in June. That, of course, being that we receive your approval this evening, as well as DEP approval in early June. And speaking with Ellen, that seems to be going fairly well right now, and we certainly anticipate that approval. Given that fact, the drawings, as will the architectural team, go over with you this evening. Both the site plan and the building plans are pretty much complete at this point. They're ready for issue or 99% there. So I think we're in very good shape at this point. We have our asbestos removal program intact, and that, if it hasn't gone out to bid, will be very close to going out to bid so that we can do the asbestos removal this summer. So I think all of the pieces seem to be falling in place. It's been very hectic The committee, since November, has gone through really an agonizing and most difficult time, making decisions that were tugging at us from all ends, be it site, building. Of course, our latest is the historical nature of the windows, which we're dealing with on the '30s building. So we're trying to grapple with all of these elements and considerations in ensuring our commitment to the community that the project comes in at the $11.7 million budget. We certainly will not be going for more money. So basically, with that in mind, as far as our site plan is concerned, we feel that the site plan we are presenting this evening, and certainly the architectural team and design team will give you the technical aspects of it, but we feel that it represents the best engineered plan for this project. Certainly has elements that we would like to do differently if we had a different site, but given the constraints and the parameters that we're faced with, we feel that it is comprehensive. It certainly will meet your requirements. We have tried to take into consideration all of the various interests, and we're very positive about our plan. I cannot overemphasize, as you well know, the start of construction in June. It is absolutely critical for us to be able to do that without having any major permitting type problems at this stage. If not, it would actually probably delay the project a year, and heavens knows how much that will cost. So with that in mind, I'd like to turn it over to Paul Stevens, who will go into the technical aspects.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. There's not really a lengthy list of things here, given the point that we're at in the project. Tom, you mentioned that you already had the information on hand on the cost of plumbing the portable classrooms, and I guess it should be obvious. I think from that information that we've made a decision not to plumb the portable classrooms. Other new information that you have and things that have changed since we were here a month ago is that you have now all of the detailed design information on the detention basin, which we did not have prior to the last meeting. We have, since the last meeting, revised the construction period and are now being optimistic and looking at an October 1995 completion date rather than a fall of 1996 completion date, and I think I should caution everybody that the documents that we're putting out to bid next week are designed around that kind of a schedule. We certainly anticipate some input from the contractors during the bidding process, and it is possible that that phasing schedule may change. But at this point in time, based on what we know, it's our intent to have all of the classes and new classrooms all fully occupied in the fall of 1996, and there will still be some ongoing work on the site after school starts that year, but all the kids should be in the right classrooms at that point in time. There is a lot of miscellaneous stuff in terms of information and small changes that I think is outlined in the letter that was given to you in terms of signs and notes on the drawings that have been added. Much in response to your requests and to the requests from T.Y. Lynn. We have made some modifications, I think, which are somewhat significant in the planting plan, in that we have changed all of these trees along the entrance road here to sugar maples, and we want you to know that we don't have all of the information on the sap collection system, which is going to be piped into the technical education section over here, but we are planning on it being underground and using an oil-fired system to boil the sap down. And we're anticipating in probably in about 30 years those trees will be be available for that kind of an activity at the school. We've also changed the flowering crab trees, which were located here and here, to pin oaks, and we have added three more pin oaks over here at this location. We've added some Turkish filberts. We still have those little guys. And we have them located on this inside island here and one located right there. So we don't have quite as many as we used to have, but we still have them. And I've got a picture here if anybody wants to look at it. And we've also proposed some additional fencing over in the neighborhood of the bus parking area and the equipment storage building, which will protect the view from Route 77. There are some things that we looked at your request and did not change. It was only a slight change, but we were asked to look at reducing the height of the light poles in the front plaza area here from 20 feet down to 16, and frankly, we could not get the photometrics to work on that. It just plain doesn't make any sense to do that. We had to end up with far too many lights in there when we reduced that down. What we have done, which we discussed last time, and this was in response to a maintenance concern from the school department, is we've removed the bollards that were located in this area right here, and we've added two 10-foot fixtures similar to the ones that are out along the driveway at that location. We have also chosen not to add the lighting on the high school access drive over here, as was suggested by some people. Another piece that we looked at in some detail was in response to your suggestion about angled parking in this parking lot. And although we certainly would agree that it does facilitate circulation in the lot, we just could not get an efficient layout, and that we were looking at, no matter which way we did it, losing somewhere between 25 and 30 spaces. I might add that at the lower end of that scale, we were looking at compromising the slope onto the lacrosse field and not having a regulation lacrosse field in order to make that scheme work. So we've elected not to do that. But we have, and it shows on the drawings that you, this is an older plan, it shows on the drawings that you now have, we have eased the radiuses or radii into the parking lot and lost ourselves two spaces as a result of that, and striped and signed the parking lot as a one-way system. And that's, I think that in a nutshell is everything that of a major sort that's happened since we were here the last time, and certainly myself and the rest of our team are, and the members of the school building committee that are here tonight are prepared to respond to questions.
Thank you very much. At this point, I would like to just turn it over to the board for comments, questions, any concerns regarding the two motions. Let's have a brief discussion and then see where we end up. Judy?
I don't know if this would be you, Mr. Stevens, but despite the changes in the phasing plan, it's still not clear to me what is being done this summer in the way of construction, what's going on during the school year, and then what would happen, whether it ends in October of 95 or the following fall. If you could just briefly outline.
I think I'll have Ellen respond to that in some detail.
Thank you. I'd like to start with the scope of the site work that will be done this summer, and then move on to the scope of what's happening within the building during the fall. This summer, the plan is to accomplish the new access road here, as well as the bus loop here, so that by fall of 1994, the buses will be coming in here, and cars and parking will be occurring up here, thereby allowing contractor staging area to be the courtyard between the two schools, which is currently parking, as you know. In addition to the access road and parking paving, we're also planning to pave the community parking lot at the south side of the ball field, because the buses will be parking off of that lot near Route 77, displacing the cars from that lot and requiring parking at the south side of the ball field. So that's the basic scope of the access and paving required. The majority of the elementary school for the fall semester 1994 will be occupied. We are planning not to occupy the C wing, which is the existing lunch building. That building will be vacant, and the contractor will be working there fall 1994. The first grade wing, second grade wing, and fourth grade wing, actually first grade wing, cafeteria wing, and fourth grade wing will be occupied by students fall of 1994. The spring semester of 1994, the contractor will have finished working in the C wing. We'll move the students into the C wing and free up this end of the building for construction spring of 1995 to the contractor. Work at the middle school will also occur. The contractor will be building out all the new construction starting this summer and continuing for a year to the following summer. The renovation work at the middle school will occur summer of 1995, so that by fall of 1995, the students can be moved back into the middle school. Also occurring summer of 1995 is the remaining site work. Which will include the finishing of the paving in this area and the completion of the parent drop-off following the demolition of the D wing. The phasing is such that we can't do the parent drop-off until the D-wing is demolished. We can't demolish the D-wing until the renovation at the middle school is accomplished. So that's the chain of events. Can I answer any specific questions?
So the new construction of any new foundation work begins this summer and is basically ongoing through the end of next school year?
Correct.
Could you explain when blasting will be required in any of those phases, including for the detention pond?
I can to a certain degree. The issue is we will defer to the contractor for some of the specific when they're going to blast here and when they're going to blast here. Dennis, you may want to address the detention basin issue. But blasting for this new foundation here, any blasting that occurs, any blasting out here, which we don't anticipate, will occur early on in the construction process, either late summer or early fall. I'd like to defer to Dennis to answer more specific blasting issues on the site. Any other building-related phasing questions? Or I'll turn it over to Dennis.
Not building-related, okay. Thank you.
Judy, could I interrupt just a minute? Would you tell us again where the parent drop-off will be during the first year?
Yes. Parent drop-off for the, excuse me. Parent drop-off for the elementary school for the first year, the year of construction, will be here at the Scott Dyer end of the elementary school. And parent drop-off for the middle school, they will use the new access road and come in here to the parking area, and students will walk into this door. That's the door that currently exists in the breezeway between the D wing and the fifth grade wing. Any other building questions?
Go ahead, Judy.
Not building, really.
On those turnaround issues and drop-offs, you might want to look at your sheets L103 and your sets. Have that information pretty well laid out. Albeit the note might be difficult to read at that scale, but your packets also included the note that was included on that sheet to define more specifically what the contractor will be responsible for maintaining access, fire access, utilities, no parking signs during the first phase, et cetera. As you can see on the plan, as Ellen just stated, we will be penetrating this area in a new access and a temporary basis for the drop-off around a much smaller island, which will be the larger island in this parking area,
and then driving back out what will be a permanent egress or permanent access and egress to that smaller parking area. We have to add a small bit of pavement to accommodate handicap parking down at the Pond Cove school entrance on a temporary basis as well, which will then be reclaimed as turf when the phasing, when that piece of the work is done next beginning of school year 1995-96. And in terms of blasting, as Ellen said, as it relates to the building, it's going to be dependent upon the contractor's schedule and where they are. There are a few places around the building where we know we're going to need to do it. But in terms of the site work, all of the utilities, whether or not they need to be blasted, have to go in pretty soon, all like the sewer, the storm pipes, detention basin, all of that is upfront work. Most of that, I mean, the contractor has some flexibility in here, but to the extent that pipes are leaving this area and going out throughout our system, those things have to be in first. And we do know that there's some blasting required right out front to get some of the pipes in and out through here. And there will be blasting required at the detention basin on this kind of northeasterly edge portion of that detention basin. And that, again, will be pretty early, late summer, early fall, probably.
So it should be all complete this construction season?
My concern, the reason I brought up blasting, and I did bring it up, I think, the first time you came before the board in a formal situation, is that the geotechnical investigation report you submitted by Gillespie and Associates does say in it that if blasting is used, the owner must be aware that some minor aesthetic damage to existing buildings is probable. And that scares the heck out of me, given that one of the ways that this was passed in the town was to point out that fixtures were falling or nearly falling on children. And I would hope that we could restrict blasting to times when children are not present in the buildings. I don't know how you could assure me that they would be safe otherwise. That was why I was leading up to this, and I'm hoping that can be accommodated.
It will be accommodated from that kind of immediate scheduling perspective, as well as from the way they do the blasting charges, the way they define how much you can do. It's all related to how close you are to a building so that those cosmetic damages don't occur. And those thresholds are pretty, well, like 2.5, 3 inches per second, and they start the blasting at like half that rate to keep it down as much as they can. And we also know that we are not permitting the contractors to blast within 20 feet of the existing structures as well as part of that need. So there will be some hand removal of rock.
I think the only other question I would have right now is the engineer submitted new comments that you hadn't addressed yet publicly, and I wondered, these seem fairly minor, if there's anything that would cause you problems if there was a blanket condition stating that plans have to be revised to accommodate his comments. The May 10th comments.
Right. I'm sorry. I was waiting for a question on that one. I guess, Jerry, do you want to go through some of those general comments as...
Basically, I don't need to go through them all. They seem pretty straightforward.
They are. They're very straightforward. Most of them have been met already. We've been discussing these things ongoing with T.Y. Lynn.
I don't think I have any more questions right now, Tom.
Thank you, Judy. Anyone else? Any other questions?
I just make one suggestion, maybe. let's see. It seems to me it would make sense to put a synopsis of what is going to be happening when and publish it together and publish it in the Cape Courier for the residents of the town to know. It seems that a lot of times people are asking me what I know about this, and I don't know a schedule. And I think it would be very helpful because a lot of them have concerns about when certain things are going to be happening. I think it would be very beneficial for everyone.
Sounds like a very good idea.
Any other, Mr. Edsel?
Just a few questions. The 4-foot high chain link fence with the detention pond, is that by state law, federal law, or insurance reasons to drive
insurance reasons?
it's considered to be an attractive nuisance or something?
Anytime, I guess, that you're impounding water that will be available or there for any length of time, and this is only for several hours, admittedly, it's advisable to enclose that or keep out kids from playing around in that water or in those slopes.
I just thought if it weren't, then that would be at least one improvement that one board member would now require, if it is required for insurance or state law.
Well, we did check that out, and we wanted to remove it as well, but...
Certainly seen a lot of detention ponds that aren't fenced in, and a four-foot fence going to keep... well, probably up to about first grade it'll stay out. They're fun places to play. Was there any resolve to the Sprague Corporation gift to the school on the tennis or basketball court?
Mr. McGovern and I talked about that recently, and he's discussed it with the board. They've expressed no concern about it, and things are fine as we're planning them. And there's a letter coming on that, or just verbal?
Question to notes seemed to indicate there was at the town council meeting on the 9th of May, I might have been there, I can't remember, regarding parking on Scott Dyer Road. I saw the change in the ordinance proposed. Was there any change from that, or I see a shake of the head. Lastly, I guess I'm just pleased to see the emergency access to the athletic fields added. I was just at a lacrosse game last week, and there was a need for the ambulance to go onto the field. And aside from trying to get cars that were parked out of the way and getting across the muddy field, it will probably be much easier once all this is in place. Appreciate that very much. I guess just lastly, that this whole process, while it's had its ups and downs and a lot of discussion, I think it's been a good process, and I'm really, as one board member, very, very pleased. I can't say I approve of everything in the building plan, but that's bound to happen in a plan this size, and I think it's been a good exchange of some give and take on ideas, changes to the plan. I think we've got a very beautiful facility planned, I'm real pleased with how the process has come out. Thanks.
Thank you for that comment.
Any other questions or comments? Mark?
Tom?
Yes,
just two minor questions I discovered. I'm looking at L101. It might be the easiest plan to see it. There looks like there now is a guardrail proposed at the top of the slope on the east entrance into Pond Cove. You had a walkway really skirting up. Little embankment. I think we commented before maybe steps or something were needed. I'd never noticed that before.
Sorry, could you orient me again, please?
If you look at the east access into, I guess, the Lunt building, you have a couple of walkways around that area. Yes. Is that a guardrail there now?
It is. Okay. It's a small wooden guardrail like we have in other parts of the site. We added this entrance is a new entrance, as of probably the last time you saw that. We had a small little guardrail there before, and now it's just longer to get into that.
So you just basically...
This is a pretty steep slope coming right down from that walk down to this lower entrance.
Okay, and if you're in the bus loop now, assuming you're a child who wanted to walk down toward the high school, it looks like there is a crosswalk toward the end of the bus loop, and then there is a sidewalk all the way down.
It's okay. An existing sidewalk, that's true, yeah.
And echoing Mr. Etzel's praise, I am thrilled how far the planting plan has come. It looks really good now, and at first it was very weak, so thank you.
Judy? Thank you. Roy, any comments?
I will ask a couple of questions. As luck would have it, my daughter plays senior softball, and I was in the area of the detention pond last weekend. And if you look at the existing map, I guess I'll go back to the issue of whether or not there's a detention pond, is it really necessary? And I'll leave that up to the best judgment of the building committee and the design engineers. However, access to the lower field In fact, let me go even further. The idea of having to blast a hole in the ground to detain water if it isn't absolutely necessary, to pay for the berming of that, if there are other ways of accomplishing that, if through the DEP process is any way of avoiding implementation or construction of that detention basin, I, as a board member, would very much support those other means, particularly since, as you've seen in the memo, the waters are discharging to tidal waters, and there's not an issue of downstream flooding as there would be with other conditions. If the other options are more expensive, that obviously is an issue. However, if there's additional money being spent simply to get around an issue with the DEP, and that money could better be spent for bricks and mortar or computers that could drive software programs that could show kids how to do stormwater calculations, that would be even more exciting. Even do SAF detention basin sizings. But I'll say this, we've done a number of projects with detention basins, and 99% of the time they're dry, and they're big holes in the ground, and they're just underutilized. This one is located, and again, we were given the information at the last meeting, and it was only during review of this set that I was able to appreciate exactly where this is relative to the fields. And I think for people who aren't familiar with the field layouts, the detention basin is typically shown as being at the edge of the work limit, and it's not really, it doesn't sink into one's mind how that works with the field layouts and access between the parking lot and the fields. So what I'd like to ask is, how does one get from the parking lot, first of all, to the lower field area, the softball and the practice field, as a pedestrian, and secondly, how would one get there as a coach with a vehicle that would have equipment and those sorts of things, which they now are able to do?
Pedestrians can get there by walking around either side of the top of that berm level of that detention basin. There currently, as you know, is a fence that precludes that kind of pedestrian traffic except for one, I guess, small opening to pass through. But the fence goes down to approximately here now, all the way through. We've removed that fence as part of the project to some extent, and then with the detention basin a little bit farther down. And for pedestrians to get through that space, instead of parking next to the wetland as they do now, they can park in the parking lot and walk around the detention basin either way. And we've located the fence on the inside of the 68-foot contour and provided where there might not be so, a 6-foot-wide grass kind of walking space so people can get around either side from that perspective. Coaches walking down could get there the same way. If one had to get down there with a vehicle, I suppose that they could get the key from the town or make an arrangement with the town to get down through on those emergency access ramps. We'll get them down to both fields relatively easily.
Would you describe how that works?
Yeah, I believe it's on L101 of your sheets, but essentially, right through this portion of the, right this location at the parking lot, there's a couple of bollards and some wood guardrail, that are provided as kind of announcing that this is where it is for an emergency situation, also to prevent people from going down through that are unauthorized. So one would mount that 4 and 4.5 inch high curb and drive right down that ramp that we have flanked on the downside of the slope with those wood guardrails, again, to orient a driver as to where the ramp really is, and go right down onto the lacrosse field, and then continue across the lacrosse field and right down in the front of the detention berm down onto the lower field as well. So there's, I think, better vehicular access down to there now than there was before even.
Have you discussed this with community services in terms of access for coaches?
No, I have not. We've discussed it with the fire chief and police chief and Bob Malley and everybody else, but not those.
Is this ramp, is this built to roadway standards that has a gravel basin and then loam over it?
It wasn't anticipated to be so, but it will be now as one of T. Wyland's comments. It'll be the same reinforced turf that we're providing for the fire accesses throughout the rest of the site, like, for instance, this location.
Would it be possible to provide access to that lower field area for vehicles that would access directly from the westerly end of the parking lot along the westerly side of the detention basin and eventually down, essentially taking the access route that exists now and wiggling it along the back of the detention basin, widening what you're referring to as a 6-foot walkway?
Widening that any more than we're already doing just pushes it farther out towards the baseball field and makes that slope taller because the grade keeps dropping away. And we tried to strike a reasonable balance between chasing that down the slope and providing some sort of access around that detention basin.
What is the slope on the back side or the on the back side facing the ball field, the lower ball field? What is that?
4-1.
4-1.
Is that right, Chair? 4-1 on the outside of the berm towards the ball field.
3-1.
Even on the outside?
And for the record, once again, would you state why the detention basin is required when the town center report recommends that or suggests that there is not a requirement for detaining stormwater in the town center?
There's a requirement to, unless you get waivers or special consideration, to prevent your post-development flows from exceeding your pre-development flows. We have done that. We've done it in a way that makes good engineering sense. There are alternatives, but they're not viable for our process, our project, where we are in time and budget right now. In order to not do the detention basin, we would have to make substantial improvements to the swale and culverts all the way downstream to the marsh, as well as document that the town, in fact, does own all of the land between our point of discharge and tidal waters where they would consider there not being a flood hazard. We all say the town owns it all, but we don't know that without going down there and looking to make sure the town does in fact own it all, to the point beyond which it doesn't matter anymore. So for our process to keep moving and for meeting pre to post post to pre-development flow rates and all other things considered with the needs of the project, time and budget, not the least of those, this solution is our best solution.
And why is the detention basin not located farther downstream? Why is it so close to the it's smack in the middle of all development and it's adjacent to the existing neighborhood? Why is it not, like many detention basins are, farther downstream?
One answer is that there's no room to provide that downstream without major impacts to the wetland buffers and the wetlands themselves. We looked at several locations, alternate locations, for this detention basin, and this is the one that worked from a space and location perspective. Excuse me, with regard to how the storm system is split, can be split, and not to get in the way of town center water when some date in the future, which we don't know when that is, might come through. As you know, we've provided larger pipes to allow that flow to continue on through, and if we put our detention basin down at one logical point, A, we don't have enough room to do it, but B, it would be in the way of those future flows, which would render it useless or frustrate the town center planning from that perspective. So we put it out of the way as best we could and put it in the location that we felt worked the best from all those considerations.
How much ledge removal have you calculated for this area, an average depth, for example?
Just for the detention basin?
Detention basin.
4 feet of depth at the deepest point.
You'll be removing 4 feet of rock to create the detention basin?
Not throughout.
But on the upper portions of
At the upper portion and at the deepest location, it'll obviously feather out to zero on each end of that, or upper and lower edges of that.
Is there any chance that through the DEP...
French fries already.
Is there any chance that through the DEP process that you would be faced with those downstream improvements and expenditures that you're trying to deal with in another way by developing a detention basin?
No. And I know there's been a lot of discussion around this issue, but there's two parts to the DEP's requirement. Part A is that if we detain our water on site, that at some point in the future, they want to guarantee that there will be a minimum amount of improvement to that swale. Between the tennis court access and the entrance to the culvert. Now that's a section of swale that they're saying, regardless of what else we do, and regardless of what the town outside of this project does, that some date certain they want to make sure that gets fixed, because it's a pre-existing bad situation or inadequate situation. That's a number that doesn't relate to the cost of the detention basin. What does relate to that is that number plus fixing or replacing all of the culverts from this point to its turning point, and then from its turning point to the marsh, which is another 350 feet of what is now 30-inch pipe, which would have to be increased to something substantially larger than that for our water. And then we'd be in the same bind with, well, do we build it for town water specs for some date in the future that we don't even know will really happen? And that would just drive the size of those pipes up even farther, and without the money to do that. So there's the two pieces to what we would have to do if we did not do the detention basin.
Okay, one last question. There's no indication on the plan of access, of pedestrian access, intended along the back of the detention basin from the parking lot. It would seem that one could use for getting to the lacrosse field and the for the recreational uses of looks like a soccer field. One can use the emergency access ramp because in some areas the slopes are fairly high and wherever we've had steep slopes in town adjacent to intensive uses, we've suffered a lot of erosion. Fort Williams is a good example of that. At the westerly end of the parking lot, it would seem to me that pedestrians would be directed toward that corner and then heading in as straight a route as possible along the back of the fence of the detention basin. What is the slope? There's an arrow on drawing L101. There's a note in the wetland area with an arrow going down toward the corner of that parking lot. What are the slopes in the area there? Are those shallow enough that one could easily walk from the corner of the parking lot onto the detention, onto the berm, and then down to the lower play fields?
From an athlete's perspective, yes. They're 3-on-1 slopes, and they're mowable slopes, and they're not all that steep. The contours make them look steeper than they really are. But there's no 10%, for instance, graded path that would be through the emergency access route.
Because I don't envision, I mean, this is a field that's used like all other fields in town, and it gets, although it's down in the corner and everyone forgets about it, it gets a fair amount of use. And I think as part of the overall pedestrian flow, there should be a clear or intended design access to those fields. Last question on the detention basin is the fence. I have had a call regarding, by another design professional, regarding use of fence, and that popular legal opinion is that the hazard is greater having a fence and having one trapped inside a dry detention basin that suddenly floods with water than it is to have people walking into it because there isn't a fence. And that in most applications now, most construction sites, one does not see a totally fenced-in detention basin. Do you respond to that?
I am aware of the comment, and based on that, I had the school department investigate their insurance company's perspective on this issue, because there has been some flip-flopping in terms of opinion about that. And after their having checked that out, the recommendation came back from the insurance carrier that, yes, the fence is recommended.
Okay. at 4 feet height?
I didn't ask that specifically, but that's your standard pool height kind of enclosure fence.
Okay. Yes, Judy?
I'd like to follow up on some of those questions. What would you say is the difference in cost of the culvert improvements, not the swale improvements you mentioned, but the culvert improvements versus the cost of the detention basin?
That's very difficult because we now have a pretty good grip on the cost of the detention basin, but we don't have the same kind of real-world grip on the cost of those replacements. I had done some original calculations, just brief thumbnail issues or estimates to try to define what that difference was before we had the detention basin really nailed down, and to say, here we have this need and we have, or this option, construction piece, we have this construction piece, what does it all, how does it relate? And to, we had a figure just for discussion of $50,000 to do the detention basin, which is not necessarily what that is, but at the time, because we had no other information, that's what we, our educated guess came up with. And using the same approach to fixing the swale and fixing those culverts and doing at that time what the DEP was requesting or requiring of us if we were to go that route, to do it without town center water would have been $70,000+, and to do it with town center water would have been pushing $100,000.
Do you have any idea what it would cost to reclaim that detention basin if and when the town finds it needs to go? Sounds like what's the better route if permitting and time constraints aren't here?
No, I have not looked at that.
Mike, could you answer that?
Yes, we could do that with public works crews, with excess material that we've generated through waste disposal. It would be the labor cost, the trucking cost, it would be minimal. The real issue, as I see it, is in looking at the detention basin versus this other solution, is the other solution is not yet engineered. We don't yet have the final town center stormwater plan. We don't know what issues we may run into, and the real fear is with the deadline for the project of needing to get it started within the bidding within the next few weeks. If we went in that direction, we started running into problems, the project would probably therefore be delayed for a year. I did do some calculations last week as to really what that meant if we were delayed a year. First of all, we're not too sure where interest rates are going. One article in the Wall Street Journal on Thursday said Morgan Guarantee said rates were going up 1.75 points. Another article more recently said that it may be stable, but say it went up 1 percentage point like it did this past year. The cost over the 20-year life of that is $1.3 million of the 20-year life of the bond. If we look at project inflation at 3% over the next year, that's around $300,000. We'd look at the continual burden of, you know, the kids in the school and the added maintenance and whatever. And anyway, I added it all together. It was about $2 million if the project was delayed for a year over the life of the bond.
What's the likelihood, or has anyone thought of approaching DEP and saying this is not the town's preference? We have these permitting issues in this time, very pressing time issue, which I certainly appreciate. But if it was the town's feeling that this was not the solution of choice, and there's a lot of drawbacks to it, to get DEP to agree to that being done in the last phase, and if we can find a better engineering solution, I certainly know, or I assume on this board, it would be fairly straightforward to come back for an amendment like that, and I would think it would also be with DEP. I hate to think, you know, this is one of those penny-wise, pound-foolish things.
Yeah, I'm very sympathetic with your view. You know, my concern is if we don't get the permit this evening, you know, we don't know what we're facing. We don't know what the DEP may do. You know, if you want to have that as the strong sentiment of the board without actually requiring it be eliminated, that would be a strong message that we could go back to the DEP and perhaps come back. But I think, you know, the important thing is that we get the permit. And, you know, if you do want us to go back, we will certainly push that idea and, you know, also look innovatively at the scheduling of this detention basin as well to see that, you know, how it fits in, possibly with looking at other alternatives. But the important thing is to have something in place that we can give to the DEP that shows this is what the planning board's approved, and that if they had their druthers, they'd wish it wasn't there. And, you know, if you'd like to work with us to eliminate it, that would be fine.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Edsel.
Mr. Chairman, just a quick comment, just as one board member, at this point in time, I want to add an affirmative voice to the detention pond process versus the other process of water quality control through the grit and the oil trap system. Number one, that type of technology, as told to us by the people from Sebago Techniques, isn't even proven. They don't know that those actually work, and it's based on a water quality problem, and there's never been a defined water quality problem here in Cape Elizabeth. The whole study was based on a water quality problem in Freeport, and just assume that we have it here. And I don't think that's good, necessarily good science to base it on that. The detention pond, I think for the purpose that it's designed, will work perfectly well.
Yeah, I would just like to put the issue to rest from my personal comments, and that is, at least from my perspective on the board, I feel that what the board would like to do is keep the construction costs as low as possible, to keep the approvals process working, and to allow you to leave tonight. Well, I think we'll see what's going to happen there shortly. It's not in any way to stonewall the project, to raise the cost of the project or anything. I see this is something that's right smack in sort of is a note of all of the circulation around that parking lot and the other facilities. And if there's a way of looking at this as you continue through bidding and so forth, through addendums or other processes, even during construction, even if there's a way of eliminating blasting 4 feet of ledge, if it doesn't have to retain the largest storm that other detention basins do, I would certainly suggest that that be looked at. With that, I would ask for a motion. Mr. Edsel.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, number one, the Cape Elizabeth School Department is proposing renovation and new construction at the middle and elementary schools, which requires a site plan review under section 19-2-10 of the zoning ordinance. Number two, the plan was deemed complete at the March 1994 meeting, and a public hearing was held April 25, 1994. Number three, design details on the plans need to be consistent to assure construction of the project in compliance with the planning board approval. Number four, it is the interest of the town that the project meet applicable state and federal requirements, and that those requirements be consistent with the approval granted by the planning board. Number five, the plan substantially complies with the requirements of section 19-2-10 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Cape Elizabeth School Department for the site plan approval of the renovation and new construction in the middle and elementary schools be granted, subject to the following conditions. That the revisions recommended by the, number one, I'm sorry, number one, that the revisions recommended by the town engineer in the attached letter be added to the plans. Number two, that the applicant receive DEP approval. And number three, that there be no construction or exterior alteration to the site until above conditions have been met and the plans revised and submitted to the town planner and town engineer for review.
We have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Do I have any comments?
Mr. Edsel, would you consider two amendments? One would be that no blasting shall be performed during regular school hours or at other times when children are using the Pond Cove Middle School buildings. The other one, this is not worded very well, is that the applicant and town pursue design alternatives with the DEP to the proposed stormwater detention basin. My intent is that there be some showing of board support for an alternative design. This is nothing that would require the applicant to do so or to return to us, but simply indicate that that would be something we would support.
I'll start with a second request for amendment. I'd rather not have that a part of the motion, just personally. I think that's an issue that can be carried forward without being a part of the order. On the first, I have to think through the process real quickly. Again, I don't know, belabor the motion for approval. If there's an instance when blasting with children in either one of the schools is a very safe situation. I'm certainly well aware that there are a lot of blasting situations where the kids are safer in that school than they were riding to school that morning. And so I'm not sure that I really want to add either one of those.
The reason, again, why I would bring that up is when the applicant's own consultant says that damage to the buildings is probable with blasting, that we've had, I don't know, two or three instances with fixtures falling from the building with absolutely no earth movement close to children, onto children. I think that's a really unacceptable risk to take, and I'd like that to be on the record.
I think there's an opportunity here to hear from, yes, Mr. Stevens.
Yeah, if I could, I'd like to say that frankly, that amendment is not, or condition is not acceptable to us as the architects and engineers for the project. I have some grave concerns about putting handcuffs on our contractor in terms of the scheduling of the project. I should add, though, that the way the project is set up, it's required that the contractor communicate with our clerk of the works and also with the assigned school administrator for the project about all activities that might affect the safety of the children, such as blasting. This is a part of the specifications. And that if we had any particular concerns, and I think your concern is a valid one, but if we do have any particular concerns about the locations of kids on a particular day in regard to blasting activities, that we could take, you know, I think the appropriate steps to make sure that the kids were protected. We've got a really large site here. We've got quite a lot of ledge in terms of volume that needs to be taken out. And while I'm hopeful that a good deal of that blasting is going to get done over the summer months when the kids are not in school, I don't think that we can guarantee that. And I think that really we would certainly like to see it left to the people who are running this project to make those kinds of decisions.
How do you respond to your own consultant saying test shots and detailed monitoring during blasting will help minimize disturbances? I think one problem with a child, one accident is just too much. And when I've been in on this process for a long time as a parent, and we were told that if things go on the way that this in the schools that they have, I mean, we're looking at condemnation possibly down the road. That makes me think of very unstable buildings. And the thought that blasting is okay near the buildings is beyond me. I would hope at least the board would agree that there should be notification sent home to parents prior to blasting. There have been other errors done, you know, in this town and on school buildings, unsafe roofs, and I guess I'm speaking more as a parent right now. And I'm looking at materials that have been supplied to us.
May I ask, Mr. Stevens, what conditions are in the specifications with respect to examination of existing conditions and documentation?
There is a requirement for pre-blast surveys in terms of identifying property that may possibly be damaged by blasting. There is also a requirement in the specifications that all this be coordinated and scheduled with the school itself, and I just feel that myself. I feel that there is adequate protection in place, and I guess I don't know that I read quite as much into our geotechnical consultant's comments. And I think what he's referring to is that there may be some minor cosmetic damage, and I think this refers to maybe some slight cracking and so forth. But I don't foresee any major damage, and I think certainly if we did have the instance that you're referring to, where we had a classroom that had some loose light fixtures or something, that would be something that we should be aware of.
And I think even a window has fallen in the past, and that's not with this kind of activity.
But I just think it's going to be a really onerous requirement on the contractor to not blast during school hours.
I don't know. Poor blasting during non-school hours could be as serious an issue as proper blasting during school hours. Is there anything in the specification that determines or sets sizes of charges or anything to that extent within certain proximities of the building?
I'm not sure about that. I could ask you, Jerry, in terms of what the sizes, in terms of limitation are in the spec.
There are limitations to proper blasting.
Okay. You want to you want to hear more about that in terms of limitations on particle velocity?
I think just for the board's information, this issue is dealt with very often, not very often, always in the specifications for the project. And the responsibility for acting in a responsible way rests with the general contractor and the subcontractors and the insurances. I don't disagree that sending proper notice home to parents, as it was suggested earlier, that a newsletter is part of keeping people informed during the entire process. I would be as concerned about noise from blasting as I would be from any effects on the buildings in terms of this age group. But I think that generally speaking, I agree with the applicant in terms of scheduling and flexibility, and that we have to assume that the school, the applicant, and the professionals working for the applicant will act in a responsible manner. And the responsibility for doing so will rest with them rather than with the planning board in this instance.
I guess then I would suggest to Mr. Edsel, at a minimum, you include a condition that would read that advance notice be sent home regarding school blasting schedule. I think we're not dealing with a particular small project and localized homeowners, and we're not talking about Murray's rock removal. We're talking about the children in this town. Mm-hmm. And I think you can't play it one way, that the schools are in danger of falling down versus everything will be taken care of very easily. There's no problems here. This is not, I mean, it's not a sound building. That's not how it's been presented all along.
I understand that, and I also understand the magnitude of the project itself and how complex and intricate making sure that the daily schedule of the work that takes place just has to keep moving. I think that all of those suggestions are very good. It's just that I don't feel that it should be a part of the motion for approval. To burden the applicant and in turn the contractor. I think that's the management of the site, both by the contractor and the school administration.
Even though we do have in the past attached conditions with respect to blasting schedules and pre-blast surveys and notification of abutting landowners, that somehow this is different?
I would be one board member, so that we have often put too many conditions on our approvals.
Okay, as a final thing, I will certainly vote for the project. I do so with grave misgivings with respect to this point, because I get backpacks full of every conceivable kind of paper that has no bearing on our life, and if this is too much to ask, there's something wrong.
I'll pull the board. Mark, how do you feel on this?
I have a question for the applicant. In that respect, in terms of your project documents, do you have the option or prerogative through project administration to require blasting mats and further protection other than particle velocities and size of charges within a certain distance of the building? Because I agree that if somebody is blasting down in the detention basin, you know, 150 yards from the school, we shouldn't have to go to unreasonable lengths.
I'll stand corrected, or perhaps someone from my team would add more information, but basically we don't in our specifications tend to well, we don't tell the contractor how to do it in terms of safety. We do restrict particle velocities, but there are laws that require the use of blasting mats and precautions in terms of blasting, which the contractor is required in the documents to comply with, but we do not spell out the detailed requirements in the documents as to how that is done, and that's the province of the contractor to make sure all those safety measures are in process. Not to say that we aren't going to be aware of what's going on the site on a day-to-day basis, and I think to try and make people feel as comfortable as possible with this, I can say that there will be every attempt made to do blasting at times when it's going to minimize risk to the kids and also minimize risk to ongoing school operations. And I certainly think it's reasonable for us to ask the contractor to try to schedule blasting during non-school hours, which we would certainly be glad to do. But what I would not want to do is to have an absolute ironclad requirement that that be the case, because we might find instances when that was just not to the best interest of the project.
Thank you.
But I think, and I will pledge to mention the concern about blasting in the pre-construction conference with the contractor, and so that we do, you know, take some of your concerns into consideration as we plan the schedule for that.
Thank you. I guess in terms of my understanding of the issue, it almost seems that it's best dealt with at the project administration level rather than notices which may turn out to be, you know, cause more concern than really the issue merits.
Okay. Mr. Parkhurst?
I'm sort of ambivalent, I guess. Having had some damage to my house done when the sewer was brought into my neighborhood, I guess I'm acutely concerned that my two sons may be in this building when blasting is taking place. And I think I share Judy Lardner's concerns, and I was mentally trying to calculate if they have to blast, they can't do it from time school starts until school gets out in the afternoon. It seems to me they should be able to accommodate that. And I feel very uncomfortable with them blasting during school hours.
While school's in session?
While school's in session, while children are in the buildings.
Okay. Roy?
Yes, in addition to the blasting, there will be a tremendous amount of equipment running around in the field, heavy-duty equipment, trucks, bulldozers, and what have you. So there's imminent danger not only in blasting, but in the use of equipment and trenches that might be open for a period of time. So I would only hope that the applicant takes all precautions on the site, and somehow it's in the contract, that it will be policed to the best that can be done to preserve any problems, that to eliminate any problems or avoid any problems on the site. Not only blasting, but also on the equipment. You know, the beepers, when things are going in reverse, maybe the kids should be educated when they hear a beeper, whatever. But I think you have an education program to go through, not only with the blasting, but also with the equipment that's going to be on the site. It's a big project, and there are many dangers and perils, but take all precautions. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to keep in mind that what we have here is an amendment to a motion, and I'd like to proceed on that basis. I will suggest, however, that blasting is not a perfect science, and that perhaps the person best capable of making a decision as to whether a child should be in the school building is a parent. The question is then, how is a parent notified in such a way that we don't have children staying home when there's no blasting going on because schedules are disrupted by rain or that subcontractor not being available on site during a specific pre-scheduled day? I don't have an answer for that. I don't know if it's possible to notify parents through a newsletter that a certain type of work is scheduled over a certain period of time on a weekly basis, for example. I think if you were to read tomorrow's morning paper and the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board is not willing to consider language that would allow parents the opportunity to hold their children from attending class during a time when there may be blasting, that perhaps this planning board could look not very concerned about that issue. I say that only from the standpoint that I know of conditions where blasting has taken place near commercial buildings and has flown in excess of 300 feet onto the roof of buildings, adjacent buildings. Nobody obviously was injured, but I think the parent is perhaps the one that should be informed of that. With that, I guess what we'll do is proceed with the motion. And as I understand it, Mr. Edsel, would you continue?
I was asked the question if I would amend, and my decision was not to amend either item.
Okay. With that, we have a motion that's been seconded. Any other comment? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All those opposed? Okay. Do I hear another motion? Do I entertain another motion?
Mr. Chairman, what was the vote?
Oh, I'm sorry. Would you move two?
I think three of us were.
Three opposed and two in favor. Motion did not carry. Could I hear a second, another motion? Ms. Lardner?
I would propose the motion that Mr. Edsel did read into the record with a final condition that the administration design an advance notice system to warn parents of all proposed school blasting and leave it up to them how best to accomplish that.
Do I have a second?
Second, reluctantly.
Yes, Ms. Lardner?
Mr. Parkhurst, did you favor total prohibition of blasting?
I'm wrestling with this because I know we have to accomplish this tonight, but I'm very, very concerned about the, having gone on the school tour, seen the condition of the buildings, and the great hue and cry about things dropping from ceilings and what have you. We don't know what's behind the walls. We don't know what kind of condition things are in. And if these buildings are more fragile than we think, and something does happen, and as Judy said, if even one child gets injured or killed, heaven forbid, it's going to be a very tough thing to live with. And I really don't feel as though I can vote for anything that is going to allow blasting while any children are on the school premises during school hours.
Mr. Emery, since there wasn't a second, can I propose a different motion?
I believe there was a second, but maybe if the second was...
A reluctant second.
If the second was withdrawn, the motion can be withdrawn.
Second is withdrawn.
Then I would propose the motion as read by Mr. Edsel with the condition that states no blasting shall be performed during regular school hours or at other times when children are using the Pond Cove or middle school buildings. I think if this becomes onerous, this is not the continuation of my condition, that the applicant can certainly approach this board again and we could consider only that condition. I'm with Mr. Parkhurst. I feel very uncomfortable about blasting during school hours.
I guess, do I have a second to that motion?
Second.
Any comments?
I just have a comment that I really think it is onerous to the applicant, who is the town, and the contractor, to whom whoever this is awarded to. I think Roy hit it right on the head. There are an incredible number of dangers that are going to be constantly affecting our children. My daughter will be in the middle school during this time period, and I'm extremely concerned about a lot of construction dangers. I think blasting is just one of those. To place a condition on this motion for approval that says that there's no blasting during, if I understood it correctly, during the school day, the school hours, or while children are in the school, either school building, I just foresee some stalling of progress on the project, which will amount to a lot of lost dollars. I think there's, as Roy said, just constant danger ahead for our children, all of the children there, whether it's moving machinery, blasting, any deterioration of the building. It's a dangerous thing to have children on a site that's under construction. Most of us would not want our children 180 days out of the year on a construction site, and that's basically what they're doing. I think they've done an excellent job in providing the phasing scheduling that they're doing to the highest degree that they can make this a reasonably safe site. I don't want to put it to the point where, you know, if you don't want your child on an unsafe construction site, you ought to find a different school for 2 years.
I'd like to interrupt just for a minute because we're really getting beyond the schedule here, and I think we all want to get to an end here that's mutually amenable to everyone this evening, and that being approval of the project. What I hear is a concern on the one hand regarding children's safety, and the other hand is the issue of information. A comment to the motion that I would make is that the information should be provided to the parents, and the decision regarding concerns of safety, as Mr. Edsel said, it could be blasting one day, it could be any other number of operations on the school site another day. But the methods and means be left to the owner and the contractor in terms of schedule and conduct on the site. That would be my comment to the motion. Yes, Judy.
Two comments is I would be willing to strike the "or at other times when children are using Palm Cove and middle school buildings," because that could be scheduled around by the administration, and leave it a restriction during regular school hours. And I would like to also distinguish this danger from other construction dangers, as those are planned for, the area is fenced, it's certain known equipment, and granted, there might happen, I guess you could have a bulldozer hit a foundation and shake something loose, but blasting by nature is unpredictable, and we have a building where things fall down now. Now, I granted, it's going to be noisy as heck with everything moving around, and it's going to be very dangerous with trenching, but I think that is a much easier danger to guard against than the blasting danger.
I would just interject, and I'm probably procedurally out of order here, but I would suggest that there may, in that case, be times when the contractor is unable to blast at all, because there will be other uses going on in the site. There will be sports activities going on. There will be parking, other activities. And I think at that point, what we've done is put the owner and the contractor in a position where they're unable to build a project. We have a motion that's been seconded.
She's proposing to amend her motion, and we need the person who seconded the amendment to agree to the amendment.
To limit it to just school hours.
Yeah, I'll agree to the amendment.
School hours while school is in session?
Correct.
We have a motion that's been seconded. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All those opposed? Motion does not carry by 3-2 vote, not in favor. I'll entertain another motion. Why don't we look to the applicant? Perhaps the applicant has some suggestions as to how we can best resolve this issue. Superintendent?
Obviously, we have had conversations within the system as to how we're going to manage this. I will say that all the way through this process, as speaking for myself personally, other projects that I've been involved with, well, schools in session and whatever the activity is going on outside, we've always relied on our professional advisors to give us a framework that we can work with. I've heard you mention a number of things that we have talked about, and I would like to assure not only the board, but clearly every parent whose child may be involved in this, that the idea of frequent and clear notices is absolutely vital. I understand that you haven't seen a lot of this coming home because there's been a great deal of activity working out the details of how we're planning for the removal of equipment and so forth, the so-called transition aspects to bring us to the summer's activity. But that kind of teamwork is already underway. I've also had conversations with our clerk of the works, and one of the things we talked about was blasting and how it's handled in the vicinity of schools and so forth. I am convinced that we have professionals who are clearly concerned about this issue. I feel as if we were dealing with a devil in the deep blue sea issue here, because even while we speak those buildings, although frankly we don't have a rash of things falling every day, it is a problem, and in fact it's still a problem and we have to fix it. So the whole point of this has been to do it in a responsible way. I'm not a blasting expert. I do not know what the best way to solve that particular problem is, but I would like to assure you that we will be doing everything that we possibly can to keep people informed, to work this through. This is a new issue for me. I had assumed that as we went through this, everybody knew it was renovation, everybody knew that there was the impossibility of removing children totally from the site. If we had that option, we would have taken it a long time ago. So I'm not prepared here to tell you every particular thing that we would do. I hear the necessity to keep parents informed. I hear the necessity for us to ask and work closely with our professionals to make sure that every opportunity to mitigate, not to do it during school hours or whatever presents itself, is investigated and explored. But I'm not prepared to say exactly what the solution to that is, but I know that the buildings are not in good shape as they are. We do have to fix them. And I would hope that we could work this out.
Just one second. Is there anyone from the design team that would like to speak to this issue?
Certainly, we would be more than agreeable to make sure that we had a provision in the specification that required notification, I would say 48 hours, notification to the school administration 48 hours in advance of blasting, which would allow notices to go out, to parents if the administration decided that the blasting was in such a location that it was needed that that be done. I think one of the reasons that we are concerned about the current discussion is that while we're all very hopeful that this construction here, which is really the blasting that's going to take place close to the school, is going to take place this summer, given the vagaries of bidding and what we may expect, although we may be hoping to open a good set of bids on the 23rd of June and jump right into construction. If we should get, and certainly our intent would be to get the major part of that blasting out of the way before school starts, but if we should have a situation where, by who knows what reason, that the project was delayed by a month or 6 weeks or whatever, what it would do, it would throw this work in here into the early fall. And I think certainly while we can do everything that we can to encourage that the drilling for the blast take place during the day, and that the blasting take place after school is out in the afternoon, and I think we would certainly make every accommodation to try and see that that would happen. I think to make that an ironclad requirement is going to be very difficult to do in terms of the project. So I guess I would suggest that if we went with a notification procedure, then that would, in terms of the blasting that was going to take place, that would allow everybody to make their own decisions in regard to safety. It would also give the school administration and Dan Reed, perhaps, who has the intimate knowledge of where light fixtures have fallen down and so forth, and the opportunity to say, well, let's not schedule class in this particular room during this particular time. And I think that really it's got to be managed in that fashion. And I guess I certainly have been involved in a number of projects where there has been a substantial amount of ledge excavation very, very close to ongoing activities, including blasting ledge immediately on the other side of hospital recovery rooms while they were occupied. And those kinds of things do take place, but you also have an absolute right to be concerned because there are vagaries to blasting like there are everything else, and so there are some concerns, and so it's proper to have them.
Thank you. Yes, Judy.
I'll propose yet another motion based on the original motion made by Mr. Edsel, with a fourth condition that advance notice, that the applicant shall notify parents of Palm Cove Middle School students 48 hours prior to any and all blasting activity during the school year.
Can I ask a question of the applicant prior to going any further?
Why don't we get a second on the motion and then ask the applicant a question? Do I have a second? Mr. Parker's? Second?
I'd like to ask a question.
Go ahead, ask the question.
Would someone be kind enough to point out on the site where the blasting is going to be taking place for the entire project first, and then number two, what they anticipate the schedule of those different areas to be blasted would be? This might clear this whole issue up for me.
I think that before I'm going to ask Jerry to come up and point out all the places where we know that there's ledge and there's liable to be blasting, I think I should caution before Jerry tells you where the ledge is, that that's where we think the ledge is. And as everybody knows, ledge isn't always where you think it is, or it's often where you think it isn't, so that there may be some other areas. But I think with that, I'll let Jerry sort of point out the areas that we have. But it's basically in the area of the new construction here, and also with the utility. So you walk them through that, Jerry.
Thank you. And I would like to reiterate what Paul stated.
We did some limited test probes out here. Have a good idea of the general layout of the ledge on site. However, the project has grown some since we first started, and from my history, we always seem to hit the low spots when it comes time to measuring ledge. But we do know generally this entire core area here, courtyard area, utilities will almost all be within ledge. The new building foundations and a portion of the floor area in this corner will also be within ledge. This area primarily is in fill. We don't expect any ledge in here, or if there is any, it would be very minimal. We do expect this corridor all through here with the new sewer line and also the new sanitary line to be within ledge throughout. And as we indicated previously, the detention basin will also have some ledge. The new roadway should not. Basketball court is also in a fill section. So primarily we're talking as far as vicinity of the building, new construction, which is scheduled for completion in fall of 94. Foundation work and utilities presumably would take place this summer along with this line and the drainage. So I would expect, if the schedule can stay on the fast track that we're anticipating, that at least a good majority of the ledge is out before school. But we can't ensure that.
Okay, well, given that information, that I guess I feel very comfortable seconding the motion that's been read.
The motion's been seconded. Any additional comments?
I have additional comment. The motion is that the general, I believe, that the general contractor notify the parents of the students, and I just can't see that...
The applicant.
The applicant.
Which would be the school department.
Okay.
Mr. Etzel, let me qualify this. I understand that this building committee, I think, has done a very good job given very difficult constraints. I respect the school board, and I certainly respect the superintendent, but you have to excuse, I think, skepticism on our part when we look at, there have been past administrations that have let the schools deteriorate to the condition they're in, which has been some threat to our children there. And we had a roof put on a building which turned out to be unsafe for snow loads that conceivably could have collapsed and had to be removed. I think one can be legitimately very skeptical that every single safety thing will be looked at. I'm not being very articulate, probably because I'm rather emotional about this. And I think requiring notice is less than I'd like to see, given the history here, despite the wonderful people that are working on it now.
Any other comments?
Yeah, just one last comment, I guess, to sort of put things into perspective. If the majority of the blasting is going to be taking place in between the two school buildings and at least the sewer lines or utility lines and foundation hole are going to be blasted this summer, it seems to me, I'm not a blasting expert, but it seems to me that the likelihood of any structural damage you do on the schools would probably take place during the summer, and we would then be obviously fully aware of what the situation was when school began in the fall.
Okay. Just as a point of clarification, the applicant stated that they'd be willing to have the contractor notify the administration 48 hours in advance of blasting. The motion states that the administration will notify the parents 48 hours in advance of blasting. There's an inconsistency there.
I didn't catch that it was the contractor. I could have 24-hour notice.
24 hours? Is that all right, Mr.
That's
Parker?
Fine. Okay.
Especially if we're looking at this is not much blasting that's expected to take place during the school year.
Okay. And any other comments? We have a motion that's been seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. All opposed? Motion carries 4-1. With that, I believe you have your approval. Thank you very much. Apologize for those who have been waiting after this. We got into discussion that was very important and one that was not expected. And I'd like to thank the board for expressing their concerns during that item.
Good point.
Oh, on my side.
No, but it's nice to have those.
That's because he's actually old.
Mr. Emery?
Yes.
I meant to say something earlier and I forgot to. I'd like to compliment Maureen and other staff people who have had to really walk a terrible tightrope, I think, representing the town and yet presenting a very clear, what I think is an unbiased presentation of arguments to and for and against various aspects. And I'd like to compliment her publicly.
Thank you very much. I would certainly second that.
So would I.
While the applicant is getting ready for the presentation, I'd simply ask the town councilor what on-air sign. I understand that there was a comment about an on-air sign at the council meeting last week, and I don't.
First, on-air.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I thought that was a new airline in time, didn't you?
We're all reinstalled here. The first item, I'd like to move along a little more quickly here. The first item under new business is Linnell Public Access Waiver and Wetland Alteration Permit. And if Maureen would give us a quick background on this, we'll proceed.
William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier own or control three lots, none of which have any access, none of which have any frontage on an accepted town road, and are located approximately behind Lyons Field off of Route 77. They're looking for a building permit for one of the three lots and are requesting a public access waiver because they do not have frontage on an accepted town road.
Just a minute, Maureen. We have a problem with the tape. Just a minute. Well, this isn't the infamous 18 minutes that we've all heard about.
You could do some impersonations.
My impersonations are all over.
For Richard Nixon, of course.
All the presidents I did have now passed on or out of office. Are we all set? Okay.
So the applicant is required to get a public access waiver in order to get a building permit because they don't have frontage on an accepted town road. The applicant is also using using a right-of-way in an existing road. The existing road is within 250 feet of a critical wetland, also protected under shoreline zoning. So the applicant also needs a wetlands alteration permit for maintenance and improvement of an existing road. Because there's also shoreline zoning in that area, and that's because the wetland is over 10 acres in size, the applicant is also required to meet the performance standards of the shoreline overlay zone. Are there any questions at this time?
And the applicant is before us this evening for completeness.
Correct.
That's correct. Would the applicant please introduce himself and give us a brief overview of the site situation according to your maps?
Good evening. My name's Steve Harding. I work for Oast Associates. We're assisting the applicant, Bill Winnell, and Joyce Gauthier in this proposal. Quickly, just to orient the board, the nearest public access is Ocean House Road or Route 77. That's shown right here. The Lions baseball field and the skating rink would be right in here. The first 130 feet of the access road is actually paved, and then for another 600 feet or so, they have an existing gravel road. What the applicants would like to do is reconstruct the existing tote road that goes into the bottom parcel. There's three parcels here. The total aggregate size is 12 acres. It's the applicant's intent only to develop the lower southerly 4.2 acres for private development with a residential lot. As Maureen's alluded, there are some resource protection wetlands in the area. The wetland that is over 10 acres would be this area down through here. This wetland extends for quite a distance off. There's also a smaller critical wetland up here, which is critical because of the soils definition. Those two wetlands combine to provide a building envelope or to set the thresholds of the house lot in this corner of the 4.2 acres. This is a 250-foot setback from this boundary, from this wetland, and then we have another 250-foot setback from this wetland, and of course the setbacks from the lot itself. The shoreline zone is pertaining to this area, and we've gone through and made quite a few provisions to contain the erosion control and stormwater concerns which could be related to this project, and we'd be willing to answer any specific questions that the board may have.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if it's been stated for the record, but it's also my understanding that the applicant has been granted a right-of-way from the town council.
I guess that should go in for the record. This parcel has historically, in the deed, referenced the right-of-way access across the Lions baseball field lot. Unfortunately, that was never defined in the past. The applicant has gone to the council, and they have agreed upon a right-of-way following the tote road, and as part of that agreement, we are to adhere to the wetland standards and the regulations of Cape Elizabeth, and that's the process that we're currently going through.
Okay. Thank you very much. At this point, what I'd like to do, this is a completeness hearing, and what I'd like to do is simply ask the board if they have any issues with respect to completeness, and if so, be specific as to recommendations for additional information.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Edsel.
And I noticed on the checklist it says Evans right title and interest in the property reviewed and indicates partial. I was looking for the note as to why the... I'll be specific about my question as far as completeness. The applicants are William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier. And one parcel is owned by another third party, Jessica, I think it's Linnell Sullivan. I was wondering why the third party is not, has the third party joined the application?
The reason that she wouldn't be a co-applicant is because the only parcel that is to be developed, if you will, is the southerly parcel, and that is owned by Linnell and Gauthier.
So the application for public access waiver is only for lot
C on C. Drawing C100.
Okay.
That's correct. And Ms. Sullivan only has interest in the upper third parcel, I believe.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Judy?
Following up on that is our memo, which indicates that this is a request for a public access waiver for three lots. Is that in error, or is that how it was applied for?
There's only one public access waiver request, and you need an approval for a public access waiver to get a building permit. all three lots are depicted on the plan right now, but I, as I've been asked in the past, my interpretation would be that if the application was granted by the board and the applicant proceeded to come forward and request a second building permit, that another public access waiver would have to be issued. So in that, we're looking at, we're being depicted three lots, but only one public access waiver is requested right now. And you need one for every building permit.
In our proposed motion to consider, it does say you're seeking a public access waiver, wetlands alteration permit, and shoreline zoning review for three lots. Would it be incorrect if it was for one lot?
I don't see any problem with changing it for just one lot. The reason I wrote it for three lots is because I was trying to, in words, describe the location of the application. And because the application depicts all three lots, that's why I wrote it that way. You could just as easily write just the one lot.
Why don't we reference the specific lot rather than one or two or three for lot?
I have a question with respect again to the evidence of right title and interest. You've indicated that's partial. Why is that partially dealt with?
I apologize for not including that in the memo. The town engineer has noted that there are some locations where, because of the extensive attention that the applicant has given to erosion control and mitigation of any kind of impact on the wetland, there have been some very significant slope work being done adjacent to the road, and some of those slopes extend outside the right-of-way. Some of the culverts will incorporate drainage that will lead outside of the right-of-way, and hoping that the applicant will be able to just indicate that the owner, in this case the town, has no objection to that work.
Is it correct to assume that with respect to item B, the topographic map, that the spot grades that were put on the plan were adequate for the town engineer's review? I mean, I don't mean to get into adequacy, so let me do that. I don't remember him commenting that we needed to have the 1 and 2 foot contours.
I also don't remember the town engineer requesting those contours, and the board has dealt with the amount of topography information it needs on a case-by-case basis.
There's also road profiles in the package as well, which give topographic information.
And again, I don't remember anything in our package indicating that code enforcement or anyone else was concerned with the amount and detail of the wetland mapping and the vegetative cover. Seem
correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments regarding completeness? Do I have a motion? I entertain a motion. Judy?
Pose the following motion for the board to consider. So let me find one reference first, excuse me. Okay, thank you. That be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier for a public access waiver, wetlands alteration permit, and shoreland zoning review for one house lot, R2-21, located off of Ocean House Road, be deemed complete.
Second.
Second. Any comments? All those in.
My only question, quickly, to make sure that we've referenced R2-21, to make sure that that's the lot that we want. It is? Okay, that's fine. So it's not 23 or something.
No. The abutter gets a permit. We have a motion, a second. All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously. At this point, we have to schedule a public hearing. And site walk. I guess, first of all, what I'd like to do is discuss the issue of a site walk. Is everyone interested in the site walk?
Yeah.
I will be out of town this weekend.
We'll have a nice weekend.
I'd like to do it as soon as possible next week. Is Tuesday evening a possibility?
Excuse me?
Tuesday?
Next Tuesday?
Yes.
Which, that being the 24th?
Yes.
What time? Evening?
Yeah, 5:30, 6 o'clock. Let's ask the applicant, is Tuesday evening inconvenient for the applicant?
I'm leaving on vacation then, next day. Monday's fine.
Okay.
Monday, not Monday?
Monday I may not be here. What time Tuesday can you make it?
Not until it'll be inconvenient.
What about the following Tuesday? The week now?
I'll be out of town, or I'll be on vacation.
We have a meeting Wednesday evening, next week?
No, we don't, it's canceled.
The
31st you have the next meeting.
Okay. And Wednesday evening possible?
She's on vacation, gone.
Steve's gone?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't hear that. Monday evening?
Monday's fine.
All right, is Monday evening okay with the applicant? Okay, what time is convenient for everyone? 5:30, all right?
Got it.
There's a better than slight possibility there'll be a game going on at that time. I'm trying to think, let's just meet there. At the, I know there's questions about the grades at the roadside, why don't we try to meet at the Shore Road and work our way into the site? Ocean House, I'm sorry, and work our way into the site. Okay, we'll meet there at 5:30, park wherever we can. We have on-street parking in Brentwood East, in case you need to park nearby.
Want to park that far away?
Yeah. Okay. And we'd like to schedule a public hearing. We have a situation where we have, thank you Maureen for reminding me, we have members of the public who do have comments, however, they're going to be out of state during the review period. And is there anyone in the audience tonight, this is not in any way a substantive review of the project, but if someone has gone to the trouble to be present this evening and would like to place their concerns before the board for our information, you're more than welcome to do that at this time. Would you please step to the microphone and introduce yourself?
I'm Emmett Nathan at 15 Wildwood Drive. My wife and I will be in Alaska when you're holding this hearing, but Wildwood will be represented. You do have our correspondence, and I think that speaks for itself.
Okay.
We have no trouble at all with Mr. Linnell's single-family home.
Okay, thank you very much. Will you be able to, assuming everything goes well with the site walk, have a package in time for the next regular meeting of the planning board for a public hearing? It's the third Tuesday of June, June 21st, and the information has to be in 18 days prior to that. Okay. So do we need a motion tabling? Okay. Could I have a motion to table to the, to, Mr. Edson?
My question is, would like a motion to table and schedule a public hearing?
That's correct.
Mr. Emery, could there be a little discussion ahead of time right now so we can give the applicant any feedback for the next?
Certainly.
Looking at this, if the issue is resolved that this is only for a single lot, and not the three, I don't have that many concerns with it. The engineer did raise some issues that I hope are not too complex for the applicant to address, and I agree with the need for approaching the town if any sort of work is done on town property. We need to have that in order.
I'd like to see something, and Maureen might already have it, making sure that the fire chief finds that the access and the turnaround as proposed is adequate. And I would like to be aware of any permits you are going to have to get, whether they're Corps engineers or DEP. And I think that's it.
Mr. Edson.
As long as we're making some comments, primarily all of my questions or comments will be centered around the legal issues of the right-of-way and a real concern as to what your rights and interests in that right-of-way are. I fully read the indenture and Schedule A, and it indicates that you have a right to pass and repass. And the wording of the indenture itself seems to indicate that by receiving this, I know the intention was to give up your rights for right-of-way in other areas, but it reads that you've given up any other rights that in that right-of-way. But I don't think that's a big legal issue. The legal issue that I have a concern for, perhaps I think you need to discuss with our Michael McGovern or the town itself. I don't want to volunteer the town legal counsel, but that has to do with who has the right to tow vehicles, whether it's the town's right and responsibility. I just anticipate that because that right-of-way is used for parking extensively, that there will be times when whoever the occupant or the owner of your parcel of land will have a hard time getting by vehicles, and the worst instance would be when it's an emergency vehicle. And I'm just concerned from a legal perspective, who has the right to remove vehicles from that right-of-way if they're left overnight, if they're there at 12 o'clock at night ice skating, or they're just completely blocked the right-of-way. I guess I'm just looking for some insight from the town legal counsel as to who has those interests and rights. Sure.
You know, if there's a baseball game and there's a car that's slightly out in the way, I don't think I would reasonably rush out and have it towed. It seems to me that on town property with functions that are sanctioned by the town, there's a before we ever applied for this, it was incumbent upon the people using that area to keep a path open for emergency vehicles. So I think that's something that was there before and will be there long after I'm gone.
I don't think that answers my question, in that the problem lies in the fact that there is no very limited parking facility at the field, and it's difficult to approve additional parking at that site. And if it were just a case of one or two cars that get in the way the night of a ball game, that would be one issue. But it tends to get very crowded, and having been there during the time, there's instances when it's very difficult in and out. I'd just like to. Probably the burden will be on our own town's legal counsel to explain to me how that would work.
Yeah, that's on our list. Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Any other questions? Thank you. Judy?
Two things that Steve reminded me of is we did have something from the Conservation Commission recommending pursuing some sort of pedestrian easement over that tote road, and then Steve, you referenced some agreement to relinquish rights to that tote road, and I think you should come prepared to talk about that recommendation that the Conservation Commission made. I'm sure you have an opinion about it, and I'd like to hear that next time. And also, just to verify with Maureen that this is a 1,500-foot road of sorts, is it considered a driveway and not subject to the dead-end road standards? Okay, thank you.
Again, for the record, does the applicant have a copy of the correspondence from the Conservation Commission to the Chairman of the Planning Board and the members of the Planning Board?
No.
No? Okay. Any other? Okay. We're looking for a motion then for tabling and scheduling a public hearing. Mr. Edsel.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered, that the application of William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier for public access waiver, wetlands alteration permit, shoreline zoning review for one lot, R2-21, located off Ocean House Road, be tabled until the next regularly, until the regular June meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Planning Board, at which time we will hold a public hearing.
Have a motion, second. All those in favor? All opposed? Carries unanimously. Thank you. We'll see you Monday evening then. Last item on this evening's agenda under new business is the gel and boat ramp application. Again, this is a completeness hearing, and I'll ask Town Planner Marino Mera to please provide some introduction.
The applicant, William Gellin, is proposing a boat ramp and a float off of his home, which is off of Birch Knolls Road and also faces onto Casino Beach. Because the boat ramp and float would be located in a floodplain zone, which has recently been rezoned to an RP3 zone through our shoreline zoning, they require a type of wetlands alteration permit. This is really something that was mandated through the state shoreline zoning. We're not calling it a wetlands permit because it's not in a wetland, it's actually in a floodplain zone. But it still uses the same process. And just to make it a little bit more interesting, you don't use the submission requirements or review standards of the wetlands standards. You use those, the requirements that are in the floodplain ordinance, which was included in your package this evening. In addition, because it's in that shoreline zone, under the shoreline regulations, if you're putting in a boat ramp, you need to get site plan review. So it's being reviewed under the wetland section and under the site plan review section. Both of those sections require that there be a finding of completeness. It'll be a little challenging on the completeness because this is really not the kind of project that typically is reviewed under those standards, and so a lot of the submission requirements simply are not applicable. And then if the application is deemed complete, the board is required to hold a public hearing under the RP3 permit process. Are there any questions?